Hi, I'm Chris Edwards with Tennis Warehouse, and we just wrapped up filming some commercials with Bethanie Mattek-Sands here at TW. And before she left, we were fortunate enough to sit down with her, and she took us through, in depth, her road to recovery.
Very cool. Going off the cuff. Yeah. Wimbledon, second round, beginning of the third set. I had no idea what was going to happen. I think it was something that, it was a slight slip, happened in a split step, and I was down, and it happened so fast. And actually, I shouldn't say that, I should say it slowed down when I went through the movement. I took a split step and I heard something pop. And as I was falling, it felt like my leg was bending the wrong way. And I kept thinking in my mind, was that sound from me? Was that my knee? What's going on? Did I do something bad? And I had all these thoughts as I was falling to the ground. And I just felt this tension in my knee when I was on the ground. And I made the mistake of looking down at it. And you could just, it didn't look right. It looked messed up. And I wasn't sure what was wrong with it. And I actually made an attempt. I took my hands and I went to touch my knee to see if I could pop it back in place. Obviously, I could not. And that's the moment where I screamed out because I knew I wasn't walking off that court. Honestly, my knee up until that point had felt pretty good. I had just come off winning French Open with Lucy Safarova, never had taped my knee. Every once in a while, I'll feel a little bit of tendonitis in that right knee, but nothing to the point where I was taping it or even really too concerned about it. So I ruptured my patellar tendon, and it was a clean tear off the bone. I actually took a little piece of the bone off, and something my surgeon mentioned after the surgery when he was had cut me open was that it was a really clean cut. It almost looks surgical in nature. Sometimes when you rupture your patellar tendon, it's a lot of frayed ends, and the surgeon's got to shave that down in order to suture it back together. So mine, on a good note, was very clean, so it was, in my surgeon's mind, an easier operation. But one thing he also noticed was it was a healthy tendon. A lot of times when you have knee issues or prolonged tendonitis, you see some degeneration in the tendon. And one thing he commented was, I was looking at a healthy tendon, it was just not attached to the kneecap. It's funny, I actually ran into John McEnroe at US Open. I told him I got away with more F-bombs than he did on Wimbledon ever without getting fined. But no, that the next 24 hours really involved, it was a lot of emotion. I was telling everyone around me, whatever you do, do not straighten my leg on this court. Like the only thing in my mind was I wanted to be in a hospital, I wanted to have some drugs, and then they could straighten my legs out. I had this vision of a war movie where they're biting on a dirty bandage, like taking a shot of whiskey and then like racking this guy's leg back into place to get the bone back in place. And that was just the image I did not want. And they were actually giving me morphine on the court and it wasn't working at all. My adrenaline was so high. I mean, I'm in the middle of a match, you know, and I was not sure what was happening. I didn't know if it was broken, didn't know if it was dislocated. I mean, at that point, you really can just go by the pain you feel. And let me tell you, that was the most painful injury I've ever had. So the next 24 hours, really, I had a lot of people around me. And it was a funny story. When I was on the court, and I was on there for a few minutes, it seemed like they were all getting ready to, they were trying to figure out how to get me on a stretcher. They were trying to figure out how to move me without bending my leg. And it looked like they were about to straighten it. And I literally stopped complaining. I stopped what I was thinking about. And I looked everyone directly in the eye and I said, I will murder each and every one of you if you straighten my leg right now on this tennis court, on the Wimbledon grass. I will come back and I'll find you. Obviously, that was probably the morphine talking, but again, this was an excruciating injury, and you know, I felt it really the whole way through. I mean, if you've ever been to London, you know how many speed bumps they have on the way to the hospital. So, you know, once I got in the ambulance off the court, we still had a ways to go. And my knee was still dislocated. It was, my kneecap was basically up in my quad, and it was painful. It seemed like it took forever to get to the hospital, and I'm sure I was, you know what, I was actually talking a lot, and it was more to distract me away from the pain. I was picking on Justin, who was with me. I was talking with the trainers and telling nobody to move me, and it was really to kind of distract myself from the pain. And I remember I got to the hospital, and they gave me something. And I remember asking someone if it really was going to work, if it was really going to help with the pain. And the next thing I remember, I was awake and my leg was wrapped up and straight. So I guess it did work, whatever they gave me. I think in this moment, there's a million thoughts that are going through your mind. And again, until I got some images, until I met with a surgeon, I really had no idea what the surgery was going to be, what the rehab was going to be, what the injury itself even. I didn't know how many tendons or ligaments or bones or what I damaged. I just knew it really hurt. So I really had to take a moment and take a breath and just kind of be where I was with the information I had, which was almost nothing until I got an MRI result, until I had that first check-in with the surgeon. But when I did finally meet with the surgeon, he was pretty confident about my recovery. You know, he didn't say it was going to be easy, but he knew what he had to do. Thankfully, the only big injury was the ruptured patellar tendon. My ACL, my MCL, PCL, all those other ligaments were intact. Now, granted, the patellar tendon is a big one to go. It actually takes longer to recover from that than it does the other ligaments, but my surgeon was really confident in my recovery. But again, that's almost getting too far ahead of yourself. You know, for me, you know, when I was laying on the court, I had a moment where I was thinking, how much rehab is this going to be? I mean, I'm laying on the court, literally, and I'm already thinking, how long is it going to take for me to recover from this? What rehab am I going to have to go through? How many months am I going to be out? I had all this momentum coming from winning a gold medal. I won US Open. I won Australian Open. I won French Open. I was going for a fourth slam in a row. Wimbledon's one I don't have. And I just had all this momentum, and it stopped, and it paused. And all these thoughts were going through my mind, and I really had to come back and be in the moment, be in the present moment, and not look in the past, not regret something, and not look too far ahead in the future. Because again, I would just be kind of guessing at that point. And I had to really trust my surgeons and my doctors and my therapists. I started my rehab 3 days after my surgery. It really took me a couple days just to kind of come off the painkillers. I'm not the best patient waking up out of anesthesia. I kind of warned all the nurses that were there with me. I wake up a little aggressive sometimes, but 2 days later, HSS trainers, Hospital for Special Surgery, and Dr. Conway worked with him. I mean, again, it was very limited, really. With this type of injury, I had to keep my leg straight for 6 weeks. I had to be in a brace for 6 weeks. There was no bending. A lot of times when you see an ACL or another ligament injury, they put you in a movement machine right away. They keep bending that tendon to get the flexion back. And for me, I had to let all my sutures heal before I can even think about bending. So obviously, the first thing to go is your quad. My right leg was about a quarter the size of my left leg. And it's amazing how fast that muscle goes away. You think of all the hours and years that you spend training, and literally in 6 days, your leg looks nothing like it did before. And it was really crazy because I've never felt so helpless. I think with all the other injuries I've had, I've been able to compensate and, you know, kind of move myself around, whether it was to get in the shower or get myself a glass of water. But with this injury, I literally needed help with every single movement. I couldn't even get out of bed by myself. I needed someone to gingerly come and pick my leg up, slowly lower it, because if there was any quad engagement, I was feeling pain. And actually, I couldn't even do it. There was just a disconnect that obviously was going to take a lot of rehab to get back. But it was just those first couple weeks that were so challenging, especially from someone who's independent and active and used to doing a lot of things. I literally had to stop everything, and I needed help with everything. And so I really took that time to kind of, again, appreciate this moment somehow. You know, because I'm a big believer in attitude. And don't get me wrong, it took me a couple days to have this conversation with myself. but those first couple weeks of rehab and were challenging just because I could do so little. I mean, I remember the first time that I was able to get out of my brace, I felt like Bambi in the shower. I had no I needed someone to help hold me up while I took a shower. And it was just, I mean, it was a real moment where, you know, you think about people who aren't able to use their limbs and who aren't able to walk or have a disability. And I was just, you know,
this next question is not going to help.
I know, I'm sure.
You want to move forward?
Yeah, that's fine. I was a long answer anyways. I'm giving you guys a lot of words. Right. You would think the more I talk about this, the easier it would get. And here I am still, tears in my eyes. The support really was amazing. I mean, it wasn't just friends and family, it was just fans and people who didn't even follow tennis that were just giving me words of encouragement and telling me their stories about being out, being injured, being down. And again, I had to really take a look at myself, and you know, I figured I had a couple options. I could accept where I was in that moment with this injury, or I could hole up and be really upset and take it out on everyone around me, or I could choose to have a really good attitude because I can't, it's something that I can't control. And I had just posted something to Instagram a couple days before I got injured, and it talked about how outside circumstances or people have no bearing on your attitude. And I was just like, damn it, I gotta like live up to this now, because it's easy to do that when you're on a high, when you're number one in the world, Grand Slam champion, Olympic gold medalist. But can you do it when things aren't looking as bright? And that was my challenge. And you know, one of the things that I also asked myself was time. A lot of people talk about, well, in 6 months you'll feel better about this. You know, time heals all wounds. I actually don't like that quote. I said, well, if I can get over it in 6 months, why can't I get over it in 2 weeks mentally? Okay, if I can get over it mentally in 2 weeks, why can't I get over it in 24 hours? And actually, if I can get over it in 24 hours, why can't I get over it in 20 minutes? And it's interesting when you, if you're really listening to yourself and you're asking yourself this question, you get a little more anxious the less time you give yourself. But really, what's the difference? It's just how you're thinking. You're thinking you're gonna have how many more thoughts between now and 2 weeks, between now and 6 months, and you're giving yourself that distraction. And I really challenged myself to accept it that moment and to get over it that moment. And I'm not saying it's not challenging and I didn't have challenges along the way, but that's one of the reasons why I came out with my dance with Lucy and Sean T the day after I got hurt, because it was one of those things that it's something I would have done if I wasn't injured. And why would I change something like that? Why would I change my mentality just because I was injured and something wasn't going my way? That'd be me fighting the present moment. That'd be me fighting something I couldn't control. And I was really determined to let that go and to consciously choose my attitude.
Tell us about the first time you got back on court. How did that feel?
The first time back on court was pretty emotional. It was pretty quick. I mean, I remember I was in my brace, and I did one of the front courts at US Open, actually. I had my coach feeding me a couple balls. But even before that, I was hitting against a wall. I was doing volleys against a wall. So that is why my volleys are going to be better than ever when I come back. I did a lot of wall practice, a lot of reactions. And, you know, it really started, I was in this huge brace. And if the ball was more than 6 inches away from me, I had to let it go. Like even that tempting thought in your mind to just dive. And it's just kind of that instinct that you have as a tennis player, and I had to almost subdue it and say, like, you got to work on control and placement so you can hit more than three in a row against the wall. So again, it was just about focusing on what I could do and not thinking about what I couldn't. I could have easily said, oh, I can't run, I can't bend, I can't do this. But instead I asked myself, what can I do? I can work on my hands, I can work on my target, I can work on my timing. There's a lot of things you can do, actually, and you just have to be open to that thought process. You really have to consciously decide that that's how you're going to look at a situation. And I think the most emotional moment actually was when the first day that I was able to do the side-to-side drill. I did 8 balls in a row, forehand, backhand, side-to-side, and I started crying. And actually, Justin ran over to me, my coach ran over to me, everyone's like, is it okay, does it hurt? And I said, no, I'm just crying because I could do it. It was the first time that I could take more than one step to a ball, and that took a few months. That wasn't that long ago. And that was a big, that was probably the most emotional moment for me, even more so than just stepping out on the court. Because again, when I come back, it's not about just coming back. I want to make an impact. I want to be better. Again, I had a lot of momentum when I stopped, and my goal is to pick that up again when I start back up. So it's not about just being able to walk on the court to say I did it. I want to do more. This injury has shown me how important your thoughts are to any given situation. Again, it's easy to feel positive when you're hitting the ball clean, when you're winning, and it's things as simple as that, but then take away, I can't walk or I can't do other normal things. It's all about your attitude. And once I had that mentality, I was able to look at my tennis game in such a different way. I was able to really see where I could improve, whether it was something technical with a backswing, whether it was with an earlier split step. How much better could my hands get? You know, one of my favorite shots are my volleys. And can I improve on them? Can I get better? And I was able to break down my whole game and see the small details. Because we all talk about these small details are the difference makers. So I was determined to find out what's that 1 or 2% that I can improve on right now, even if I can't move. The movement will come. That's the thing. In my mind, I will eventually be able to move. I will eventually be able to run. I will eventually be able to jump. What can I do before that? I gotta let go of thinking, I wish if only, oh, I would have gotten that ball if only. I could only practice when I can do this. No. What can I do right now to get better? And I think another interesting thought that came out of this was when I started doing a little commentary, I actually started breaking down some of my opponent's games. That was the most tennis I've watched, and I was basically doing film sessions on players that I was going to go back and play, and really actually explaining my thought process and explaining my game out loud to the fans and to the public helped me learn a little bit more about myself. I actually mentioned a couple things, I think, when I was breaking somebody's match down, and I thought, wow, I didn't even know I was looking at the game like that. So I think it's really kind of been this journey of self-realization, and that sounds very new agey, but it's something that, you know, when you're out on the tennis court and push comes to shove and there's a tight set, a tight game, that's when all these little emotions come out. That's when everyone could be cool, calm, and collected at other times, but those are the moments that you want to capture. And I feel like when you know yourself really well, you're able to not only win, you're able to dominate those moments in matches. And to me, that's why this whole process is, I see it improving my game and being a better tennis player because of it. As far as scheduling goes for my rehab, I've been a little ahead of the game, and really not on purpose. Again, I went through this process listening to my doctors. I really didn't push anything. I told myself to listen to my body. It will give me feedback. I'll know when it's time to jump. I'll know when it's time to change directions. You know, I'm a big believer the body's meant to move. I enjoy being active. I love playing tennis. And at some point, it will feel okay to do that. And I didn't have to push it. And I feel like when I've had this mentality, I've actually recovered faster. I remember thinking of past injuries. I had a couple hip surgeries. I've had some ankle sprains and whatever it was. I remember always being anxious to come back, and you always try and push that line a little bit. And if I thought about it, that never really helped me get on the court faster. So I said, you know what? I'm going to enjoy my time off. I'm going to listen to my body. I'm going to do my rehab. And trust me, it was hours every day. And when my body wants to move more, it will tell me. And I really paid attention to that every day. And that's one of the reasons why I'm ahead of schedule. I mean, I didn't do anything that my doctors wouldn't approve of. I mean, certain benchmarks for me, you know, to get to 90 degrees, to get to 100 degrees. And I needed to hit those before he allowed me to do more. But once I had my quad engaging, once I had some of that range back, he pretty much gave me free rein. He said, listen, you'll probably hurt something else before you hurt what I fixed, because what I did will hold. So I have confidence in that. And I think that's one of the reasons I've been able to build my confidence in my knee, because that's a big part of injuries, is being not, it could be better, it could be healed, but you don't have the confidence on those wide shots, those sliding shots on clay, those backwards overheads that you're trying to hit, all these, you know, out of position shots. That's when you really got to trust your body to get you through that. And that's sometimes the toughest part about injuries. And for me, my knee has felt pretty stable for a long time. It's felt tight, if anything. So I feel like that's helped a little bit with me building some confidence in it. But part of that is really telling yourself how it feels. I mean, I wake up in the morning and I think about how strong my knee feels. I'm on the tennis court and I think about how much my knee, how good it feels to run around, how good my knee feels after a great practice. And it's just that constant mentality that has helped the progression as well. And I think some people only think it's physical. They only think it's rehab. They only think it's a therapy. And so much of it is in your mind. And that's what I've really paid attention to this go around. And I think that's why I'm recovering faster than I ever have before. I think the trust in the knee was gradual. It definitely went from feeling like Bambi and being unstable, just this newborn deer, not knowing where your foot was, not knowing where your leg was in space, not being able to do a hamstring curl on my own, and just gradually building that up. But I think along the way, it's important to mentally be on the same wavelength as your physical therapy is, because again, you'll find that 6 weeks later the injury is healed, but you're still not where you think you should be, because you're not trusting it. And that's part of what I talk about, listening to your body. It wasn't about pushing it past, but it was about knowing where it was comfortable. And you know, I had confidence in my trainers, I had confidence in Dr. Conway, I had confidence in my surgeon, everybody at Hospital for Special Surgery. They did a great job. And you know, it's a journey, but I think that's okay. I think sometimes people look at this road like it's this daunting mountain that they gotta climb. And I feel like if you're looking at all your challenges in life, you're missing a lot of life. If you're only looking for these peaks of winning a grand slam or that gold medal podium moment or just that amazing clean shot, that perfect set you played, you're gonna find your happiness is really far in between. Like, there's a lot of in-between life there. And I've really learned to stop and enjoy the process and enjoy the moment. As much as it's hard to say that, how can you enjoy the rehab, the training, the pain? And I really found a way. I found a way to enjoy it, to be present. And again, that's why I've been able to build up the trust in the amount of time that I have. And I'm really excited to be back on the court. But it's interesting because I got asked that question a lot. I got asked, don't you wish you were out on the court? Even when I was watching matches, I bet you can't wait till you get out there. And I kind of laughed because I said, no, I can, because it's not happening now. Mm-hmm. So why would I want to wish for something that can't happen now? That's not fair to myself. And again, I'm not staying present. And so I could watch tennis, I could be around tennis, I could be on the court with limited movement and still find things that I enjoyed about it and still find things that were making me better and still celebrate with players who were winning instead of me, because it was okay. My time to be back on the court will come. It's just not here yet, but it'll be soon. And when it happens, that will be great. But I was doing my best to make each moment in this process the best.
We hope you enjoyed this video. And Beth, a big thanks to you for hanging out with us here, getting all the commercial work done, and also taking us through your road to recovery. Wishing you all the best from everyone here. Have a great season.